Indeed, welcome all. As the song says, you are the love of my life. Yes, right beside me, right here. Love of my life. Yes, good night, everyone. It's a privilege for us to be with you, and thank you for sharing with us and allowing us to share with you in the things that God has done for you in this COVID-19 season. Hallelujah. And we want to, at this time, open up in prayer. We're going to ask Garfield Haywood to just open up in prayer for us, please. Thank you.
Bless the name of the Lord. Father in heaven, as we come before you this night, mighty God, we magnify you, Lord. We lift you up, mighty God, because we know that there is no other God like you, mighty God. Father, as we come before your presence, mighty God, Father, we pray that, dear God, that this night will be dedicated back unto you, mighty God. Father in heaven, I pray that, dear God, that ministry will be easy tonight, mighty God. And Father in heaven, I pray that, dear God, that this topic, that God, that will be ministered, that will be shared, mighty God, that Jesus, that it will reach, find our shortcomings, dear God, and reach our hearts, mighty God. Father in heaven, we pray, dear God, for each and every one of us that is gathered here tonight, mighty God. Father, we pray that, dear God, that our souls will be glorifying you tonight, mighty God. Father, yes, as we listen, mighty God, as we entertain each other tonight, mighty God, I pray that, dear God, that our souls will be lifted, mighty God, as we honor you in our marriages, mighty God. So, Father in heaven, we just pray that, dear God, that you will lead us tonight, mighty God. Direct us, mighty God. Jesus, Father, I pray that, dear God, that you will touch the Normans even now, mighty God. Give them that word, mighty God, of wisdom, mighty God. Father, I pray, dear God, that Jesus, that your anointing will flow tonight, mighty God. And we tell you thanks, dear God. We magnify your name tonight, mighty God. In your holy name, I pray. Amen.
All right. So we're looking at affectionately yours. And tonight we're seeing so many of you online that are joining us. It's good to see all of you again, and we know you're praying for us in this COVID-19. God is strengthening families and our love for one another. We are growing in our love for each other. Yes, we have to be at home together a lot more, and so anything that was not settled has to be settled, you know, and so with the help of God, we're going to have all of those issues sorted out. And when we deal with things God's way, we actually end up being better than we were before. So, affectionately yours. Yes, Mary, what?
Good night, everyone. Yes. Good night. It's just an awesome privilege to be able to have this platform the first Saturday of each month to just come together as couples and share and be strengthened in our marriages. And we do spend some time to pray about each month's topic. And this month, the Lord has said we should look at affectionately yours, affection in marriage. This is going to be two parts. And we are going to basically just open the topic of affection. We're going to share for a while and then open the floor for discussions, for questions, for answers, and for answers from the Word of God. And so I want for you to relax. These e-rooms are brought to you courtesy of the Global Church and Bible Teachers International. They have given us some e-rooms. We have 6 e-rooms per month, and they're used for different purposes, one for marriage, one for Christian teachers, 2 for Word Vibes, and 2 for Passion and Purity. And so we do give God thanks for this platform. If you see on the flyer, you would see e-groups. E-groups are attached to e-rooms. You can go to the e-groups and post questions. It will be picked up in our emails and we will answer them. But tonight we are looking at affectionately yours. Mm. And we know when we are courting, I want you to just put your mind back down in memory lane. When you are courting, it was wow. It was like a wildfire, affectionately yours. You couldn't get enough of each other's time. You couldn't get enough of each other's love and affection. Now, in the marriage, if we walk in the Spirit, which is basically walking according to the Word, we will find that affection will run throughout the entire course of the marriage. And so we're going to be looking at the ins and outs of affection and affectionately yours. Andrew, are you affectionately mine? Am I affectionately yours?
Well, that's a question that we should, it doesn't hurt asking and examining, because, you know, we may see some areas that we need to improve, and we may see areas in which we are distracted. So we may need to, or we are off balance. You know, so whatever it is, we need to work on it. And it may be that we are a good example of being affectionately each other's. Maybe, but the you know, as we discuss tonight, it's going to become clearer and clearer as to what's really going on, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's a scripture verse that we want to look at tonight, 1 Corinthians 7, verse 4. The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband, that's when love is flowing, right? And likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. Is that a good thing, husbands? Let me hear from some of the husbands. Is that a good thing that the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife?
Sure thing.
Who is that? Garfield saying a sure thing, yeah. Right, so the wife has power over your body as a husband, yes? Wow, that's interesting. That's physical affection there. Yeah, okay. Because when we're talking affection, we are talking, part of it is being physical. Yeah, so what else? You know, us men like to be in control. And now to hear that somebody has power over our bodies is, to hear that our wife has power over our bodies can sound frightening. Or is that a good, is that, well, one husband is extremely elated about that. Let me hear from another husband. What kind of emotions does that leave you with or make you feel? The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband. Mm-hmm. And likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. Yeah. The Johnson said that he's okay. You're okay with that? All right. He's just okay with that. All right. Okay. All right. So, all right. So let's take it a little bit further here. Maybe.
Yes. And, you know, years ago, we did a course called The Thought War, in which we looked at the fact that all of us were made for with a craving for affectionate touch, kindness, consideration, and love. That is what God intended for us to give and receive, right? And in the context of marriage, that is something that should be natural. It should be natural in the context of the family, but in terms of, oh, my husband is elated about that scripture. All right, he may say yes. And it's a scripture that, you know, today, I'm coming back to the what we're made for. But today, as we looked at the word of God, it's just a way how God is, in this time, he is downloading the record of what he has said concerning marriage. And so the marriage is honorable platform is one where we allow the mind of God to speak about a union that he has created, one that the devil has tried to sever. And as the word of God comes each month, and it is broken down in our spirit under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, it is going to cement us together, because by him, the word, eternal spirit of God, all things consist. And so marriages will fall apart, marriages will break up if they are not held together by the word. And so I'm very excited about the scripture. That means I have power over your body, young man, and you have power over my body, right? Wow. How do you feel about that? Before we go on to what I was saying.
Well, that's interesting. That's what I would say. I mean, you know, it's interesting and to allow, in other words, I don't feel I need to fight that. I actually want to explore the beauty and strength and I suppose handsomeness of that.
Okay, what God is saying, all right.
Yeah, their emotions. Yeah, that's something that I would want to explore and experience more of.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. The body, you know.
Okay. All right, let's go a little
further. So we haven't heard anything from the wives. How do you feel about the fact that your husband has power over your body? Anything from the wives?
All right, before we go on to the affectionate touch, kindness, consideration, can we hear from two wives?
Right.
How do you feel about the fact that your husband has power over your body?
Right.
I'm talking in the healthy way now.
Well,
let the two wives respond.
The Bible talk about it in a healthy way. The Bible is not unhealthy.
I have mixed feelings about it, to tell you the truth, because my husband used that as like a little weapon over me with certain things. So, yes, I have mixed feelings about it.
All right. We'll get back around to that.
Is he beside you?
Fine by me.
He's sleeping.
Huh? You sleeping?
Okay. Yes.
All right, can we have another wife? Thank you.
I'm saying it's fine by me. I don't have a problem with that.
All right.
Oh, great. That's a happy husband there.
It is interesting to know, like the male say, it's interesting.
Sorry, who was that? That was Joan?
Yes.
Okay, great. Wow, healthy.
Yes, and so we were made to get affectionate touch, kindness, consideration and love. And when that's in a marriage, it's a beautiful thing. When you know your wife considers you, she loves you, she touches you with affection. And we're going to show some of the things that hinder that kind of lifestyle. And we are going to look at it together in the Word. And hopefully tonight we will leave here more affectionate to our husbands. The scripture says be kindly affectionate one to another. If God can say that in the context of the church, everybody be affectionately kind towards one another, much as in the context of one flesh. He means that affection should be running rampant through our lives. Right, Andrew?
Yeah. Rampant is a strong word, but that's yes, certainly. Running very lively. Yeah. Natural affection. Wow.
Yeah.
Yes. So we want to just share for a few minutes, and then we're going to have you respond to questions and comments. We want to learn. I was listening to someone share today how her children, when they were younger, always wanted to hug on her and you know, and all of that. And she would like me, trying to push them off. But after a while, she learned that it was okay. I guess she didn't grow up with a lot of that. But, you know, God has a way. Sometimes even our children teach us. And so that's God's faithfulness in our lives as parents and as adults. So pretty much God is trying to get us to express our many thoughts and feelings towards each other through acts of kindness. Because as we said, we were saying earlier that affection is not just physical, it is also thoughtfulness, it is emotion, there's an emotional dimension to it. Acts of kindness, you know, giving gifts. This book, the 5 Love Languages, goes a lot into some of the ways that love can be expressed and some of the ways our persons respond to love. Some people are very touchy-touchy, huggy-huggy. Another person is what communicates that love to another person. So we are encouraged. Yeah, kind words, mm-hmm. Right. acts of service. You know, some persons, they understand love best when we serve them. Or when, you know, some of us say understand love better when we are served. You see people sacrificing for you, your spouse. Words of affirmation, as we said, poetry, song, body language, coding. Husbands and wives should develop their own coding. Communication in public, it's not everything you can say in public. It's not wise to say everything in public. You have to have your own coding language. Mm-hmm. A soft answer turneth away wrath. And of course, we had mentioned affectionate touch. Did we mention gifts?
Yeah.
Wow, that's something that some people, some of us really appreciate, gifts. We don't understand that the person really loves us until we get a gift. And there's some measure of communication of love, but that really brings it home to us when we get a gift. As we said, there's also public affection. I always mention how in my trips to Puerto Rico, I noticed the Hispanic people are very publicly affectionate. Mm-hmm. You know, husbands and wives are very publicly affectionate. They show affection. They learn to, like in the evenings, there's a park there and you see the couples, you know, walking and, you know, just being affectionate towards each other. These appropriate displays of public affection. The Bible talks about Abraham and Sarah playing together. And the king saw them and knew that they were not just, you know, they were more than just friends or siblings. They were,
I never heard of it before. You can find that scripture quickly, please.
Well, I'll look for it in a minute. But what happened is that he was trying to hide the fact that this beautiful lady was his wife because he was afraid that they would kill him to take his wife. And so that's another story. But displays of affection before children is also very important. I remember there's a gentleman named Major Lewis who has about 10 or 11 children. And you wouldn't believe it if you see his wife. And I mean, I think they adopted some on top of that. And he was saying that, you know, he displays public affection before his children for his wife. And children actually feel more secure when they see husbands and wives, fathers and mothers, showing that kind of affection toward each other. Yes. Also, one of the ways we can diffuse conflict is by acknowledging breaches of consideration. So I know sometimes we want to move on and we want to say, all right, let me do something nice for my spouse. So just get past the situation. Something happened, some kind of, you know, conflict happened between you and your spouse and you want to just move on. But sometimes it helps to stop and say, okay, I know that I overstepped or I spoke a little bit too loud. You know, acknowledge the feelings of your spouse before you actually try to just move right along as if, you're not considering their feelings, which might not be the case. You may just want to make it up and move on, but, you know, make sure that we acknowledge the feelings of our spouses. Mm-hmm. Acknowledge the breach of consideration, or if there was one, or of trust, whatever, however small or large it was, acknowledge it. Where there was some kind of inequity or person felt like they were treated unfairly, don't just brush it up aside and act like it didn't happen. Or person felt dishonored in the way you responded to them in public or wherever before the children, you know, and show some godly sorrow for that where there was a breach.
Yeah.
You know, and with genuine, so we display, we diffuse conflict with genuine affection. If you were the one wronged, sometimes the person don't feel bad already. And I'm not saying we can't, you know, let them know that we weren't pleased with that. But sometimes the way to let the person know that you're forgiven is for you to just come forth with some genuine affection. So, okay, I know, you know, you messed up there, but I want to let you really know that I've forgiven you, showing the person some genuine affection that the person understands and interprets as love. Not only what you interpret as love, but what the person would understand and interpret as real love.
It's very important that we understand each other's love language, and because the love language is what can help us to be able to show the kind of affection that the person desires. I mean, some persons love to just be told that they are special. They love for you to tell them something that is true, and it's coming from a pure heart, a sincere heart, kind words. Mm-hmm. Some persons love to be touched and to be handled and to be considered. I mean, and guess what? As Christians, many, most of us on this are on this call tonight, the show tonight, are Christians. And I have found that if you listen to the Holy Spirit, He is a master lover. He is Mr. Lover, 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 Lover. He will show you what to do and how to meet your spouse inside of affection, inside of sexual expression, inside of verbal expression, inside of any kind of affection. I mean, there are times when he made sure you just mix a nice drink, your husband's favorite drink, with ice, and just meet him somewhere where he doesn't even expect it. Give him that drink and give him a kiss. I mean, you don't have to strive. We don't have to strive to come up with ways to love. The lover lives on the inside, and he is. Know that we're learning that when you have the Holy Spirit, you are one spirit, and your thoughts are His thoughts when you're in the Holy Spirit. Don't you think He wants the marriage to be like He intended it? That's why He says, husbands, love your wives. And He says, wives, honor and respect your husband. He wants to do that to us momentarily. But unfortunately, there are some things that can block us from showing affection. And we are going to look at about three of them now. And then we have a short clip for you. And then we're going to come back, right? But I know, for example, the way we were socialized. Mm-hmm. I can tell you that I love Andrew 100%.
Show it.
But guess what? I am not one who loves public affection, right? And he's one who loves public affection. And so I've had to look at why I don't like public affection. And I think it's my tradition. I was not brought up in a context where I saw a lot of public affection. He wants to hold my hands across the road and kiss me in the middle of the street. And I'm saying, no, you understand me? And so sometimes it's the way we were socialized, it's the way we were brought up. And so I am coming out of that. No, I must say I'm coming out of that. Then what can prevent affection in the home too is unforgiveness. And never pile up offenses. Never, ever pile up offenses. Because when you do, just deal with one thing and leave it. Never bring up what you did last year to build up a case. Each case must be handled separately, or else if you keep building a case against each person, you don't forgive, then it will block the flow of affection, right? And also, a misunderstanding of what affection is. Some persons just think that affection means sexual intercourse, right? No. As a matter of fact, the world has blown up sexual intercourse. Mm. So that when we do seminars with young people, we tell them that married people don't have sex all the time, all the day. It's like the world makes it seem as though sex is this forever thing that people do. And sex, morning, noon, night, and whatever. And then you have to show them the reality of that, the fact that there are different ways to express affection. You show affection by how you take care of me, by how you love me, by how you esteem me. You know, I stood at the bedside of a man when his wife died. I went to visit the house, and she died while I was in the room. And he had gone to the pharmacy, and he came back. And when he came to the door, he saw the children, and he saw the look on her face, and he knew that she had gone. And I watched him come up to the foot of the bed, and he was just rubbing her feet. He put one foot over the next, and he was just rubbing them. And I thought of that. I wonder if that husband, during her lifetime, rubbed her feet. And maybe it was something that he did, but it left a picture in my mind. If indeed our bodies belong to each other, it means that I'm going to ask us a question, which I would love to be answered in when we open the floor for question. Have you been very kind and loving to your husband and your wife's feet? I know Andrew loves my feet. He lotions my feet for me. He's running after my elbow with too much lotion. And sometimes I have to say, that's enough. No more lotion. But guess what? If indeed this is my body, this is my body, and this is your body, we need to begin to look at how we take care of each other's body, right? And this show, as we go in this series, we are going to get more very practical. Oh, Jesus, Mishka's feet, rubbing those hairy legs. Yes. Yes, I'm always rubbing those hairy legs. Yes, it's your feet. And some couples, yes, they have smelly feet. But guess what? We need to take care of each other's body. All right, so we have said pretty much enough relative to that. What we're going to do is we're going to switch to another kind of affection that is tied to something we did in the last E-room, and then we are going to open the floor for discussion. Now, this kind of affection is tied to a spiritual activity, which all of us need to get into. It is a part of affection, right? So write your questions down. We're going to hear from you. We have looked at the fact that God wants us to be affectionate. When you walk in the spirit and you walk in love, affection is natural. Even in the scripture talks about being without natural affection. How much more the sons of God? And some of us need to look at what is it that hinders us from showing public affection. Sometimes it's the tradition that we have, and sometimes it's unforgiveness that we have. If you have not been affectionate, look at what is blocking, and we are back blocking your unforgiveness, blocking you from forgiving each other.
Our cleaning up is proof. We are persuaded, fully persuaded, it will be a good day. So we put on the shirt, slip on the jacket, strap our shoes, grab the bag, pick the car key, and we are ready to open that door to what the day has behind it. But stop! As you both set out in the morning, ready to pour yourselves into your work, stop, wait a minute, slow down a little, come back, hold our hands, place yours in his. You may lock up in an embrace, it's fine. You may rest on his chest, that's cool. Take a deep breath and say a short prayer. Speak into her day, prophesy into his. No, this is different from family devotion. It is way different from quiet time. This is speaking. Don't make it long. You can keep it short if you want. Yes, I know you already prayed when you woke up in the morning. This is different. This is speaking. This is speaking as one with authority. This is a declaration from one who has the authority. Agree on what the day should be. Establish for yourselves how you want it. Speak! Speak! The lines fall for him in pleasant places. Jehovah shields her continually with favor. The hand of God be upon her for good. The spirit of excellence rests upon him all day. He makes right decisions today. Her heart indicts of a good matter. Sovereign God garrisons her heart with peace. The Almighty keeps him from all evil. Speak! Speak! Declare it! Speak into the day. Decide what the hours will supply. Do it on Monday. Make it happen on Tuesday. Show up on Wednesday, report on Thursday. Thank God it's Friday. Saturday's got nothing on you. It's a new page on Sunday. It is not in the length of the prayer, it's in the consistency. It's not in the loudness of the petition, it's in the commitment to it. It's less than 60 seconds.
So basically we're saying that affectionate touch and consideration can take place in any context, not only in sexual intercourse, but in lovingly embracing your spouse and praying them off for the day, in getting back to eating together. Some couples have drifted away from eating together around the dinner table and touching each other. It's a good video. Thank you. It's a good video, and it's something that we need to practice. So we are looking at affectionately yours. We have made several points. Now we're going to open up the floor for questions and answers. But before we do, we want to say welcome to those who joined us after we started. This is Marriage is Honorable. It's a monthly, every first Saturday show that we have here, sponsored by the EU, the Global Church Bible Teachers International. And Marriage is Honorable is actually the family life expression of passion and purity. So here we are again tonight. We are building. God has commissioned us to install and download the record of the fact that marriage is honorable to our generation. We are both marriage officers, both ministers, and we are committed to helping to build strong families across Jamaica. So there you have it. We will tell you at the end of the program how you can get in touch with us, get in some of our groups, and have your marriage strengthened. But over to you, your questions, your comments. God wants us to be affectionately touching each other, and to say in our hearts, I am affectionately yours.
Yes, I really like that point about the whole thing of background playing into one of the things that can stop. For me, Sean, I was the more, you know, bubbly and affectionate person, the hug type. And so over time, it has come nowhere. I would, you know, be hugging and I want a hug and that kind of thing. But I didn't grow that way to the hugging and the public, you know, thing for me. But Sean, I was just anywhere greeting. And so for me, that has been, you know, something that I do know that helps a lot. And just saying about the sharing, Uncle, about with children and in the presence of them, I realized that Malachi is like that though. He wants a hug and that kind of thing. So I too have to embrace that, you know, in the whole thing of the relationship. There's a question now though. For somebody who is maybe struggling with that, how is it that they, you know, what idea or tip can you give them to quote unquote break out of that kind of mode that they will be in, to embrace that part more?
Let's hear from persons who are in the audience first. Let's see if we can have an answer from a couple here.
Well, you can start with small gestures, probably holding hands while, you know, walking, you know, simple things to get to the bigger things. So even if you're not touchy-feely, a little touch every now and then to soften the person, probably that can work.
Right. Okay, thank you. Anybody else?
This may not be well, in my opinion, I think the mere fact that you observe the fact that complacency can be detrimental to the health of the relationship. It could really spark someone to really put more effort into not being too comfortable, but trying to make an effort to you know, enhance the emotional aspect of the relationship. And that involves what the person had said before I started speaking.
That's so comfortable, you mean taking the other person for granted? Is that what you're talking about? When you say too comfortable.
Not necessarily. That could be one aspect of it, but also if it is that, you know, you we basically have an have a idea that you have the person already. So, you have the person already, you don't need to make much of an effort or so.
Okay, familiarity breeds contempt. Okay, yeah, I understand.
And let me say that, let us shake out of that familiarity thing, couples, because guess what? I was drawn to somebody last week who pointed me to one of my students online who was, she was devastated, angry and bitter with God because her husband was killed in a motor vehicle accident, and she was just, I'm just bemoaning the fact that I'm 30 and he's gone. I'm 30 and he's gone. Let us not save up love and affection. Someday I'll hug him. Someday I'll help to, I'll rub his feet. Someday I'll kiss him. Someday I'll use my china. Someday I'll put on that special negligee. Someday I'll rub her back. Hey, that someday must be now in this pandemic. We need to show affection. I mean, I think what the Lord did for me recently is gave me a fresh baptism of love for Andrew. And at least what is happening in my heart is that I am, when you decide that, guess what? I want for you tonight to hear the word of the Lord, because it starts with the word. But if you are here and you're not a Christian, we are inviting you in this context to give your life to the Lord as a couple. Surrender your life to God. God wants to press refresh on our marriage. And he wants to tonight show you that, guess what? Your bodies belong to each other. You have power over each other.
Experience. Yeah.
And he wants you to have that. And so what God has done for me is, this week was his birthday, and I looked and I said, wow, thank God we have had so many years together. And I went out of my way this time to make sure that he had one of the best birthdays ever. I did everything that God put in my heart. God showed me what to cook, what to buy for him, how to treat him. And that's why I'm saying, ask God. You see, we pray about a lot of things. Ask God to show you how to practically love your spouse. This is the season for it. We are mentoring marriages because God has given us a mandate to lift the standard of marriage. We're going to be having our marriage conference next year, where we look at some of the practical tips that we have had and pull them together for the next generation and for this generation. So ask the Lord to show you. You don't know how to do it. Ask him to show you. It starts with a simple hug. Some of you are beside your spouse now. Reach over and hug them.
Get a good book too. Of course, who would love to hear that their spouse has fallen in love with them again? Come on.
Right. And God can, and that's what that's
awesome.
And when that happened, when that spark flew in my heart again this week, I said, you know what? Andrew, let's look at affectionately yours, because we are affectionately each other. And by the way, some of you here, if, for example, strange flesh entered into your marriage, the memories of strange flesh can hang over you like a weapon. The devil brings it back. But guess what? If both of you have forgiven each other and the memory comes back, you need to stand on the power of the word that once you have asked God to forgive you, he will forgive you. Because when strange flesh enters, both of us are married. We are one flesh. If one of us is unfaithful to the other, sexually,
or even emotionally,
we have emotional adultery or physical adultery, we have allowed strange flesh to enter the marriage. And therefore, that breaks down trust, that breaks down unforgiveness. But I'm thinking of a couple. I mean, when the man was unfaithful, the woman was devastated to the point that when she spoke to me, she felt like all hope in life had gone. And the moment she forgave him, I'm telling you, it's like God pressed reset on that marriage. It's like, because he can redeem the moment. And if you are married to someone today and you are still married to them, it is the will of God that you stay together. And so therefore, what we want to do, because one of the things that we prayed about the show, and we asked the Holy Spirit to break the power of unforgiveness and to refresh some marriages that would have been severed by strange flesh, and to cause you, and you will know that the power has been broken if you agree in your heart. You'll find that when you even enter into a sexual relationship, the next time you're going to find that that fire is there again, because you have decided that, guess what? You know by your act of forgiveness have taken back the power over the other person's body and vice versa. God is giving you back the power over, and they are willingly consenting to it. And therefore, you can move ahead loving each other as though you have never loved each other before. Questions, comments? We want to hear from one or two more of you about what we are sharing tonight.
Just one more point. I don't remember who was mentioning the fact that you could read books.
Yes.
But I remember when
you mentioned
about marriage, you know, last year, the 27th of December.
Speak up a little louder, Britton.
Yeah. Pardon me? You're not hearing me clearly?
Yes, I'm hearing you now, but your voice had kind of gone down.
Okay. I'm saying that there are various books. We were reading a book. I don't remember the name of the book, but it's a little book series by, I'd have to drop the name of the author in the comment section. But it's a really good book. It points out stuff that we as couple, godly couple, can do to really spark more interest, more emotional affection, and overall improvement of the health of the relationship. So I'd really recommend, you know, reading godly, you know, relationship books.
Right. So yeah. One of them is Act of Marriage is One.
By Tim LaHaye.
Tim Tim and his wife, LaHaye, yeah.
You can actually also read Love Languages together. But let me just say that lovemaking takes place in the mind first. And so some of the affection, it touches that. You see that couple that prayed together a while ago in that thing and in that clip that you saw, it's the kind words you say throughout the day. And in these days of technology, you have to also be very mindful what you put on your phone. Anything that is on your phone is not private, but you can find ways to encode messages and call each person. We have gotten out of the act of calling. A phone call is just as important, but you need to be able to, we need to begin to express affectionate touch, kindness, and consideration throughout the whole day. If you're considerate towards one another, you see, the older people never had so much distractions, right? They never had phones. They were away for the whole day. When they said prayers, hugged each other and kissed, they were away, and they had no phone, some of them, to contact each other. But all day long, their spouse was on their heart. Who is on your heart all day? I mean, I can honestly say that Andrew is on my heart all day, Andrew and Jesus. And then I have room for my family and some of the persons I minister to. As a matter of fact, I think I have a very big, loving heart, but in my heart, I think about him, and I know he thinks about me. It's kindness and consideration. So a part of affection, guys, is that let's begin to get back on thinking about our spouses. Right. No, yes, those persons had 12 kids and no distraction. Another thing, too, that has robbed our affection, you can't spend so many hours in front of Netflix, fall asleep in the living room, fall asleep. Some of you husbands and wives, get up from out of the TV and go into your bed in the nights. Too many persons are rolling over in the city at 3 o'clock in the morning and their spouse is in the bed alone, right? Or television was not supposed to be center stage. Affectionate touch is about talking to one another about what really matters. Sometimes ask your spouse, what do you like about me? Don't wait until the situation comes up. What don't you like about me? How did you feel about what I said to you? So we have to rebuild the family altar, rebuild affection inside of our marriages.
Yes, I have to say we were distracted by church to the point where nothing was happening at home in a lot of cases. And God wants us to bring some of that focus on the home and understand the power of family. Yes, all right. Any comments, questions? Comments and questions.
Okay,
yes.
We have Let's time for
help each other here.
Okay.
Let's help each other. It might be something that works for you that, you know, might say that sounds too simple. But if it works for you, it might help somebody else.
Question. How can you show affection to somebody, you know, that probably is holding on to past hurt from childhood days or whatever? You know, some persons have been hurt.
Right.
Really bad, so they're very cautious, even in a marriage.
Right.
They're very cautious about affection, and you know, they only see affection as probably one type of way, and no matter what, that is their way of showing affection. How can you assist a couple or anybody at all? Because it's not just couple, probably a mother and a child.
Yeah, I would say the first thing that comes to mind is that, you know, good postmarital counseling is very good for, you know, you'd be surprised what a good Christian counselor can, how effective that can be. You know, of course, thank you for that. There's a need for forgiveness, yes, but how to practically move the person to that is something that counseling can help to do.
Can I say something, please? I'm glad you said in the context of the family. What has been happening to us is that we've been getting quite a number of calls from primarily children and older people too in this pandemic. And I'll just share one brief one that happened. One suicide case last week, one this week. But inside of that call, that little young lady I was dealing with, she was really, really, I mean, bitter, angry, giving up on life. You first have to trust the Holy Spirit. There's really no formula. And bring what He wants you to bring in the situation if you are the spiritual believer. Start from where people are and not where they need to be. So the approach to that little girl was to just talk about the importance of life. And then one of the main perpetrators was a parent, and I asked the little child to say what she liked about the parent and what she didn't like, to make a list. And trust me, that child had, in the natural, you would say she had real case, but the more she looked at the good things, because the scripture says that when we are not thankful, our hearts become dark. And so you can help that person by bringing them to a place of thanksgiving. If it's a spouse, in your time together, you can begin to look at things that are working and give thanks for them. Say a husband doesn't know how to hug and kiss and whatever, but he's a good provider. Start there. Thank him. Okay, thank you so much. Look at what you have done. Begin with thanksgiving, right? And pray that God opens the door to minister forgiveness, because that little child, I mean, by the time she wrote, well, mommy is kind to me, mommy provide, mommy that. But then she started to show the other things that mommy was not doing for her. But at the end of the situation, at the end of the counseling, she ended up seeing that, guess what? I have much to give God thanks for. And mommy had been mean to her, but she saw in her little heart that she needed to pray for mommy as well. And we had a wonderful prayer time for mommy. And by the time mommy got in the picture, mommy had come to a place where mommy saw that what she needed to do. God will give you strategies as to how to work with that cold person. Love them where they are at. Pray for them and trust the power of the Holy Spirit. Trust the power of love. Love, there is no weapon against love. God is going to give you an instruction to break the back of that unforgiveness that is in that person. And He might just show you somebody who needs to counsel that person. But never give up.
Yeah, so there's, we're saying, that I'm just giving different things that God can use to help that person. But one thing you can also do is to model forgiveness for the person. I'm sure there might be situations, because normally bitter persons can spill, some of that bitterness can spill out on you. But if you model forgiveness and toward a person, real forgiveness, let them see that, you know, you are okay forgiving, and the liberty that, the freedom of, that that brings you into, and how that just, you know, that keeps you with a good attitude. You model that before the person. You know, sometimes we want to teach persons, but what God wants us to do is to be an example of what we're trying to tell them to do. We sometimes move into too much of an instructive mode instead of just modeling to our spouses what we want to see in them.
One more thing before the question. The way to help that person is not to side with them. Because the more you rub in the offenses, we can rub in the offenses. I've dealt with a lot of bitter persons. And there are times the Holy Spirit might give me a question like, can you think of two good things about this person? Or accentuate the positives. Agree with them, yes, that person did you wrong. But if you're born in the iniquity with them about the situation and about the person, that the person, you only reinforce that negative hurt. Encourage them to give it up. Encourage them to know that they can't go to heaven with that unforgiveness. Just model forgiveness, right? There's another question. I hope that answered your question, Tracy. Can someone read a question, or somebody has a question? Can you go ahead with it, please?
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
All right. So not a question, just probably some little nuggets. As it relates to marriage, like for me, by the way, this is Melrose. So for me and my husband, right? Some little things that we do, we will be able to sit together looking on the same phone screen, watching whatever it may be that we're watching, talking together. If it is that I am having dinner and my husband comes home, he can just start eating out of my plate. You know, we share. We are having drink, or I'm having a drink, or he's having a drink, and we share with each other, you know? As it relates to even the lotioning of the feet and all of that, we sit down and it is easy for us to rub each other's feet and you know, just be friends with each other, be friendly. And as you say, I mean, even throughout the day, so my husband is the one who will mainly, so he will call me. I call him sometimes too, but Chef will call to just check in. How are you doing? You know, what's happening and all of that. And so living as friends, it makes marriage easier. We never always had it easy because we have been through the, what you call it now, the strange flesh. We have gone through that. And, you know, forgiveness really does work. And then you get into this whole thing of feeling brand new. So the marriage starts feeling new and you fall in love with each other again. And, you know, it is just like the first time you met and you feel awesome together. And especially when you have Christ in the mix, it really does make a difference. So, you know, that's what I'm praying together. So we pray together. That is one of the things that we do too, in order to, you know, just keep things going and, yeah.
Right. Thank you, Melrose. In answer to the person who asked, what do you do where there has been no affection in a marriage for a long time? A lot of cases, what is happening is that one person is waiting on the other person to start to be affectionate. Just like we heard earlier, if we start with little things, the important things is not to try to fix it in one day, but to start and be consistent. Consistency is the key. You know, be consistent. Instead of trying to change the other person, you model what is affection to you. Model, and especially, you know, ask the person what would they like, you know? Don't just assume. That's what communication is about. How can you show them affection? Because you want to show them affection. You want to show them that you love them, you know, and you appreciate them. Ask the person, you know, and they will tell you, you know, if somebody asks me, What I like, I'm gonna say it. She's asking what I like.
All right. By the way, let me just say this quickly. We can give you. See, we are guidance counselors. We are pastors. We are marriage counselors. We can give you the process. As Christians, we can take you through the process. But coming from your spirit, which I'm going to give you a spiritual answer now, because if you have the Holy Spirit, you already have the mind of Christ. I'm going to pause here to say I'm inviting some of you to follow us on the word track that we have in our lives that has stabilized us. We invite you to get a hold of our word vibes, get a hold of the MSOG revival that is happening. If you go on any of our pages, you will see the word vibes. They are intended to build up your spirit so that you can be built up. One of the reasons we accredit strength to our marriage, the strength is in God. We are one flesh and one spirit. What happened to some of your marriages? You are just one flesh, meaning that you've been joined matrimonially, one flesh. But God intended for marriages to be one flesh, one spirit, meaning that both persons are in the spirit. Now, guess what? The answer to all questions, the answer to all problems in the world is in the spirit, meaning walk in accordance to the word. So if there is not affection, anything that is not righteous stands from one person or both persons walking in the flesh, walking out of the love of Christ, walking in pride, exalting your way above. The Bible says only with pride comes contention. Only with pride comes lack of affection. You need to humble yourself to each other and realize that God has put you in a place where you serve each other. God forbid, we speak. One of the things that God has said when the couples come on the show, speak health, speak for protection, pray against accidents. God forbid that you would lose your spouse and not having showed affection. We have to drop the pride. Some of you have not had intercourse in a long while. That is pride and rebellion. You don't have power over your own body. You have locked yourself away, and there are different ways that we will have a show that talks about sexual intimacy, because there are some persons who are not affectionate sexually because of things that their husband have told them to do. I don't like this smell. I don't like what you do. I don't like your approach. I don't like that you are too rough. Different situations. Whatever the thing is, you need to settle down and get the mind of Christ and talk about physical affection. This week, couples, sit down and talk about physical affection. Talk about emotional affection. We want these are not just idle rooms. We want you to build your marriages with what you're getting from here and so that you can help other couples. So that's basically, and some of you, this is, by the way, excuse me, do you know how beautiful your spouse is? But guess what? Lust will blind your eyes.
Show appreciation.
Lust will blind your eyes. Unforgiveness will blind your eyes. I remember one man, he treated his wife so bad. He was so unfaithful. He did everything. He treated her like whatever. And the day he got an encounter with the Holy Spirit, his wife was a pastor, by the way. She cried, he cried when the baptism even. He opened up his, he said, "Me never know say you're pretty." And he kept looking at her, he kept staring at her. Pretty much like our pastor who had a husband who beat her, who abused her, who cheated on her. She caught him in bed with another woman. But guess what? When God opened his eyes, when she went to his apartment, there were these giant-sized pictures of her. And just all over the room, his eyes had come open. Do you know how beautiful your spouse is? But sin has blocked and blinded you.
We thank God also for Melrose, who shared her testimony earlier about experiencing, third parties coming into the marriage, or what we call strange flesh. And I'm sure that your forgiveness probably triggered a healing in that relationship, because... You know, we many times forget to acknowledge even examples that are right before us, you know, and thank God for that example also of Apostle Banks. So Melrose, would you say that your forgiveness, you had to forgive first before the change began?
Oh, yes. And not only, I mean, forgiving my husband, but, you know, also deciding that I was going to forgive whoever it is that he was with.
Oh, yes.
You know, and started praying for that person also.
Right.
In order to heal. So I, you know, I did that. And that helped the healing process and really changed things.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. So, yeah, because when your heart, when you have a forgiving heart, it's not going to just be in one area. The heart is forgiving. So everybody that I entertain, they will experience that forgiving heart. So in truth and in fact, as you said, we can't hate one person and then love another person with the same heart. You know, we have to have that heart to love everybody, including the offenders. Like you said, thank you for that. That was really good. So it's possible. Mm-hmm. It's possible. And we have examples in this group this evening, and we really appreciate the examples. I think if we really stop to listen, there are so many answers that are given in these settings. If we really ask the Lord to open our ears, Lord, open our ears so that we may hear what you're saying to us through the different examples and these persons who share their experiences. Yes.
Amen.
So what we're seeing is that there are not only offenses and hurtful experiences that happen, but if something happened 15 years ago, you still have to decide when you get up this morning to hold on to that, for that to control your life. You know, you can decide that you're going to forgive that and you're going to let that go. And also in the process of letting that go and in healing the marriage, again, counseling again can be another way to help to deal with that. You know, there are persons who want to talk about things, but they don't know how to approach your spouse to really say it. And in the presence of a trained counselor, it becomes easier. And also a mentor, you can also have a trusted mentor that both of you trust, that you can both speak to, mentor or mentors, possibly preferably another couple that you trust, that both of you can speak to, and they can speak to the issues in your marriage, you know, and help you to overcome even those financial challenges, wisdom in handling your finances, whatever the challenge is.
But it's all about consideration, kindness, affectionate touch, and love. We have time for one more comment or question, and then we have to wrap up. I'd like for one or two persons to just share one sentence about what is the takeaway from tonight's meeting.
My takeaway is love keep no record of wrong. So inside of what you guys sharing tonight, that if we truly love each other, then whatever happens inside of the marriage, then we'll take it to the Lord, and he is the final say-so, final authority, and so he know how to work out things inside of the marriage, because I see this platform working, because every time we come on and you guys share about the different things inside of the marriage, I always take on a nugget from what you guys say and work with that. And I see that working. So I really thank God for the platform.
Thank you, Marie.
Amen.
Ronnie, trust the Holy Spirit to show us ways in which we can be affectionate to our spouses. Notice that the Bible talks about the fruit of the Spirit.
Amen.
So the Holy Spirit is a lover indeed, and he will show us how to love. He will teach us how to love.
Yeah, well, my takeaway listening is what Pastor Norman would have said about being consistent, because I know, like, after sessions like these, you know, you go back and you start again, but you're not consistent in the actions of affection. Yeah, so as what Ron says, you know, just trust the Holy Spirit, as Auntie Danet says, the Holy Spirit is a lover and it is already inside of you, so it can, you know, direct you as to what to do.
Of course. Thank you, Maurice.
My takeaway is modeling what you want to see in the in your spouse. So for example, if your spouse is not
okay,
Janet, so what is it that you see happen? Yeah, right. That is my takeaway.
Great.
Okay, mine, love our spouses where they're at.
And pray the Holy Spirit break down boundaries.
Yes.
Love your spouse where they are at. Don't allow yourself to be traumatized when you see where your spouse really is or where they really are. Don't allow yourself to be traumatized. Ask God for help to say, okay, this is what's happening. So now, Lord, show me what to do. Sow kindness, sow affection, and watch what God does. Number one, when you sow kindness, you are free because you are naturally made to be kind, to be considerate, to show love and affectionate touch. So when you sow it, you are there's a freedom that you come into that is very attractive. You know, you'll smile more. And you'll be very, you know, that beauty that's in you will begin to come out more.
Guess what? When we were young and we were dating, or we were younger. A kiss felt like 1 million butterflies was racing through your heart. Some of you, the measurement of your affection tonight can be seen by the way that you hardly kiss each other. You don't enjoy kissing anymore. And guess what? These things are not something that you must throw. This is as you make a decision. What we want for you to do tonight, we want you to make, I'm going to say, four things that I'm charging you all to do. Make a decision in your heart, because this marriage is honorable. It's coming against the spirit of divorce. It is challenging Christians that they can love one another. We did not go through the whole thing of infidelity, but God has made us walk through lack of finances, where for 14 years, Andrew was strictly full-time volunteer, and I was the one working, right, as a teacher's job, and yet he led me in contentment. We have been through the fact that some of you here, I know cases here where you don't have any children. God has not had given us any biological children. He has made we have been a long distance relationship for 4 years when he worked abroad. So there are many things that God has had us walk through in our relationship so that we can show you that by the power of Christ, nothing needs to break your marriage. So we are saying tonight by the power of the Holy Spirit that we want you to make a decision that till death do us part, right? That means you need to determine, is this the will of God for you to be together? And if you are married already, it is the will of God because he hates divorce. If you are divorced, well, we understand. But right now you are married to each other. Some of you are distracted by the fact that you are thinking of someone else. Whenever strange flesh enters your mind and you're not being adulterous towards each other physically, but someone else is in your mind, I'm telling you that is crazy. That person does not belong in your mind. You need to repent and be vulnerable and say to your spouse, if you know they can handle it, I have been thinking about somebody else. We just need to be honest.
And secondly, that's if your spouse can manage that, because
right.
I've known situations where that's not a wise thing to do.
Right. But you
need to get help, though. Right. That's for sure.
Right. Second thing is that, guys, you need to get on a word track with each other. We have been recommending the Word Vibes devotional that we have. It's 100 days of fresh impact devotion that you can have together. As a matter of fact, we're going to be doing something with the couples based on what a model we see working in a family, and the reflect and response is just building up one another. We're going to encourage couples to go on that for 100 days. you can order that book through us, or you can get it on Amazon.
I think a lot of times with that devotion thing is that people don't have a problem doing it. They agree, but many times they don't know how to do it. And with the busy life that we lead, so I've had to be actually giving people, as it were, like a little outline as to how they can do it. First 3 minutes prayer, first like 10 minutes reading, whatever. The next 3 minutes, each person give their views on what was read. And then a closing prayer that's less than 20 minutes, call it 20 minutes. And, you know, because, you know, fast-paced life, but I almost said thank God for COVID, we can slow down a little bit. But we need to be practical about it. Not everybody has the same appetite. You know, one lady the other day told me that she wanted to get up 4 o'clock every morning. I'm like, okay, you have to make sure your spouse is in agreement with that. And she wanted the 3-4 hours of, you know, and I'm like, not everybody have the same appetite. You have to respect the other person's appetite, right? If your spouse have a very big appetite for something, you have to make sure that, you know, you understand that and be realistic also in trying to meet the other person's, you know. Sorry, yes, go ahead.
Yeah, so practically speaking, I'm giving you some practical solutions.
The question is that a devotional specific for married couples? Not really. But what the devotional will do, or just the Bible itself, you know, did you know that there's a book that talks about how couples should make love and all of that thing in the book of Songs of Solomon? Wow. But what I'm saying is that when you read the word or a good book together, could be a marriage book, what it does, it helps you to communicate with each other. So you're doing something together. And that always strengthens a marriage. Mm-hmm. And the consistency, as I said before, is what really, really helps it.
I found a free marriage devotional on Kindle that I can share with couples who want. But the thing about the Word Vibes book is that it deals with issues of the heart. So the Respond and Reflect, there is the link for the book on Amazon. The response, it's basically dealing with matters of the heart.
You can get it from us.
And you can get it from us. It's only $1,400
from us. Amazon is more.
Right. But what I'm saying is that, guys, the reason some of you are in the plight that you are in, you are not spending time together to pray. And I have no, Andrew is the one who's probably a little bit more lenient with whatever, but I'm saying to you, I know what makes our marriage work, because you can never go to the word together with a pure heart, and prayer doesn't come out of it. Most of the issues that we pray for comes out of our time in the word.
The bottom line is like we're saying here in not so many words, but you're not just a physical person, you know, you also have a spiritual dimension to you, and there's also your emotional side, of course, as we know. There's you know, how you manage your social. So when you are way off balance with your social life, and well, almost a thank God for COVID again, we are forced to spend time with each other, or we can have actually more exciting times together.
Well, and the night is far spent, and we don't want to keep you up. We want you to go and make some very good love tonight and affectionately love each other. But what we're saying to you is that what we want you to do is, if you are new on this platform, and there are different ways to contact us, we have Marriage is Honorable Facebook page. We have Marriage is Honorable YouTube channel with videos that we have done that can deal with infidelity, that can deal with financial problems, childlessness. Go on YouTube and find our channel and go through some of those videos. We are on Instagram, and also we are recommending the Bread for the Nations Word Vibes. Our church is also in a revival, MSOG, where you can come on and get revival every night. There are so many different platforms. Also, for those who want to be more integrally involved, we have you in a broadcast where we can send you the link each month. Certainly for the new year, the 2nd of December, we want to have 100 couples online. We are going to be inviting one or two couples to come on. January, okay. Which is the...
That's my meeting. Birthday, 2nd of December. That's confusing.
Right. We want us to come and basically look at what the Lord is saying for couples that for the new year, really pitch towards the new year and hear what the mind and heart and God and bless each other and turn our hearts Godward to each other going in the new year. And of course, as I tell you, next year we are working towards our marriage conference where it may be virtual, but it can, if COVID lifts, it will certainly be face-to-face, because God has commissioned us to tell the world and the Christians that marriage is honorable. We wanted to just thank you for coming. Don't leave just yet, because we want to really pray. Making love may begin with doing any of the five ways to show affection. Yes, and guys, I want for you to open your hearts right now and begin to be thankful for these platforms. Begin to be thankful that, guess what? When I called Family Life Counseling the other day, it was 4,500 per hour for marriage counseling, right? Of course, we do marriage counseling, but guess what? We our rates are not like that. And because we are pastors, we come from the pastoral. We use the Family Life model, but we come from the pastoral angle. And what God has said, get the couples together, spend some time once a month. We have other platforms too, but spend some time once a month and practically prevent some of these persons from having to go to Family Life. Of course, there are ministry that needs to continue, but not at the expense of some of the problems that you are encountering. If you hear the word of God, you do not have to go through months and months of counseling and weeks of counseling. Here and your soul will live.
And even if your marriage is going good, the counseling, what it does, it actually, post-marital counseling actually helps you to say, oh, so, you know, it kind of just strengthens you and say, okay, so these are the things I'm doing right, and I can actually use it, share these best practices with other married couples. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing wrong with hearing things confirmed. You know, the worst case scenario is that you will be encouraged to continue to do the things that you're doing that really works.
So we're going to have that video, and then Andrew is going to pray for the couples. If you have special needs, put them in the chat to him privately or publicly. But he's going to pray over the couples, and then we have one closing song after that.
Far from your eyes, the fallout snow from a wounded soul. You hold inside the hurt of great divide. The hole is starting to get old. So come back to the light, to the love you will find. It's been here all along. So come back to the starting of finding your heart that you always belonged to me. Just take the road. I'm ready to explode with how bad I want you back home. So come back to the light, to the love you will find. It's been here all along. So come back to the start.
Amen. All right, so we are praying and we are believing God with you right now in the name of Jesus that there will be restoration, that you'll get the courage to try again. You'll get the courage to start again. And what one thing helps is that, like I said, if you can get another couple to be accountable partners with, or someone that you both trust, that helps. So in the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you for your love tonight. Thank you for all the word that you have spoken. Even as we have shared the truth with you, we have shared the truth that works. We have shared what God has done in our lives. The testimonies of the Lord is sure, making wise is simple. And so, Father, we bless you right now that one sows, another waters, but you are the one that gives increase to each marriage here. And so we are believing you to give increase to marriages here. And Lord, that the children of the families represented here will experience the healing that comes from seeing their father and mother loving each other and glorifying your name. We pray for forgiveness to flourish. And Lord God, that we'll not be impatient. We'll remember your own mercy in our lives while we were not walking in love towards our spouse. We'll remember your love towards us in not condemning us and destroying us or allowing us to just die in that state. And so as we remember your love towards us, we ask that you help us to help each person to show that same love to their spouse. So we thank you now, Lord, for hearing and answering prayer in Jesus' name.
I heard the Lord says, let it go. Amen. Hallelujah. It will take you to your grave. The Spirit of the Lord is here, and he has come to here tonight with healing in his wings. Mm. He wants to put you back together again. He wants to wipe the slate clean. And if you can agree in your heart that the slate be wiped clean tonight, he's wiping it. And when he does, he puts it in the sea of forgetfulness. And he remembers it no more. And some of you, there's a person right here, what you need to do is, by the Spirit of the Lord, begin to pray for the person who your spouse fell with, like Melrose did. He wants you to do that from a pure heart, and you have the anointing. The anointing is here in your heart for you to drop the charges. Hallelujah. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we are calling forth a generation of couples who are holy and pure and righteous, who will have a family altar where the fire on their altar never run out, who will be examples of righteousness. And so I agree with everything that Andrew just prayed, that God will take all of us to be through to a process. We are not through a process. Right now, the day you hear his voice, I want you to agree, hallelujah, to agree that you will, your marriage will be a pattern of good works. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you. Mm. May he give you peace. May his countenance be lifted upon you. Go forth in the strength of the Lord. Love one another. Show affection. Be kindly affectionate one towards another.
Thank you.
Right. And love each other.
Media. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Let's love each other. Let's love each other as we go off to bed. Mm. Those of you who are inclined, go and make love to one another. Because guess what? God, that's God's idea. Express affection to one another.
Yes, you, Garfield and Karen.
And
thank
we
you.
We love you. We love you.
And all of you.
Right. See you.
Second that's advice.
What was that, Garfield?
I said I'll take that last advice.
Yes, more love each other.
Yeah, that's a good advice.
You know that Jesus is right there with you. And when you live your life to the glory of God, everything you do becomes an act of worship. Some of you have been ashamed of sexual intercourse because you don't see it in the mind of Christ. When you live your life to the glory of God, everything you do becomes an act of worship. We want some of you to get in touch with us. And the bulletin board will put up a number so you can get notifications from our marriage group as to when we have meetings. Just stay connected. When you live your life to the glory of God, everything, including lovemaking, is an act of worship. So keep yourselves in the love of God. Show affection towards one another. We love you, and we love you, and we love you.
All right. Bless you guys.
Have a love good you guys. Life. You're a blessing.
What's the number? Which number we should give?
Who's asking?
Somebody was asking for a number. All right. Let me give you this number. 876-353-8962. You can WhatsApp that number if you want to be added to a group where you can get some broadcasts. We love you guys. Awesome night. God bless you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks again.
Yeah, thank you too.
Good night.
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 Night,
everybody.
Yes, thank you.
Night, Reverend Jeff Godfrey Watson and Sharon Graham and everybody. Smithy, Tom Brown.
Good night.
Good night. Good
night, night. All right.
Marianne, good night.
Good night.
Bye. Laughter is good for the soul.
I agree with you, Donette. I agree with you.